It's fine. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. So first of all, thank you very much for the invitation. So my talk will concern decay estimates for the massless Vlasov equation on the exterior of Schwarzschild black holes. So in order to give some motivation, let me start by saying a few words about the Einstein-Vlasov system. So these equations are used in order to model collisionless particles of mass m, for which we neglect all interactions except the gravitation. So more precisely, the solution is a Lorentzian manifold with a Lorentzian metric and the velocity distribution function of the particles. And we have first the Einstein equations, where on the right-hand side, we have the energy momentum tensor of the Vlasov field and the Vlasov equation, which is a transport equation. So the evolution of the particles are described in phase space. And more precisely, the Vlasov field is defined on a subset of the cotangent bundle, which is often called the mass shell, and which is defined by this set. So it is, of course, completely equivalent to define it on the tangent bundle, but I found it more convenient in order to see the analogies with the wave equation to define it on the cotangent bundle. Okay, and in this talk, we will study massless particles. So the mass m is equal to zero, and the mass shell is the bundle of the future light cones. And what we can say is that the Vlasov equation reflects the fact that the particles are following null geodesics. So maybe one main open problem concerning this system is the nonlinear stability of the subextremal Kerr black holes. And the first step in order to say something about this problem would be to study the asymptotic properties of the solution to the massless Vlasov equation on a fixed Schwarzschild background. So this means that we completely forget about the Einstein equations and we only study the massless Vlasov equation where the metric here is fixed and is the metric of Schwarzschild spacetime. So there was only one work on that topic, which is the one of Lars Andersen, Peter Blue, and Jeremy Joudiou, where they obtained an integrated energy decay estimate for slowly rotating Kerr spacetimes. But the thing is that their estimate does not provide a good control of the solution near the event horizon and near the trapped null geodesics. So one of my goals was to prove on Schwarzschild an estimate which give a good control of the solution near the event horizon and near the trapped null geodesics. And moreover, I wanted to prove Pontoise decay estimates for the components of the energy momentum tensor of the Vlasov field, which is something that they did not obtain. So the main idea of the proof is to use vector fields method. And for this reason, I found it convenient to recall the main elements of vector field method for Vlasov field on Minkowski spacetime. So in that case, the Vlasov operator is much easier to write, and it reflects the fact that the particles are moving along straight lines. So vector fields method are well known for being a robust method in order to obtain decay estimates for the wave equations and Vlasov equations, at least on Minkowski spacetime. Okay. And the method was developed by Kleinormann for the wave equations a long time ago, but for the Vlasov equation, this was developed more recently by David Feynman, Jeremy Joudiou, and Jacques Moulevici. So the main ideas are the following. So first, we need a set of commutators, which are vector fields, which reflect the symmetries of the equation. So in the case of the massless Vlasov equation, these commutators, so the vector field which commute with the Vlasov operator, are the complete lift of the conformal Killing vector field of Minkowski spacetime. So we do not need to know in detail what is the complete lift, but the thing is that we take the conformal Killing vector field of Minkowski, and we add a similar part in V. Okay, so the TX part of these commutators are exactly the same as the initial conformal Killing vector field. Then we also use constants of motion, which are weights defined on a phase space, and which are preserved along the null geodesics, so that they are solution to the massless Bleskov equation. In order to obtain a uniform bound on the solution, we can use the fact that the L1 norm of the solution is preserved in time, and we can use the good properties of the constants of motion and the commutators in order to propagate weighted L1 norm of the solution and its derivatives. And using that, together with weighted Sobolev inequalities, which are often called Kleinermann Sobolev inequalities, we can obtain Pontoise decay estimates for the solution. So maybe an important remark is that since the commutation vector field for the wave equation and for the Vlasov equation have the same part in Tx, these two methods are compatible, which means that we can apply both of them in order to study the solution to a system of wave equation coupled with a Vlasov equation. And it led to the stability, to proof of stability of Minkowski spacetime for the massive and the massless Einstein-Vlasov system. So now we can start by studying the massless Bleskov equation on the exterior of charged spacetime. And I will start by saying what are the difficulties compared to the case of Minkowski. So first, the set of the commutators is much smaller. So here we can only commute with the complete lift of the stationary Killing field dt and the complete lift of the rotations. So the problem concerning the constants of motion is quite similar. We only have the t component of the velocity vector and its angular part. As in Minkowski, we have a conservation law which arises from the fact that dt is a Killing vector field. Okay, so we can prove boundedness for L1 norm of the solution, where here the integrand, which is the contraction of the energy momentum tensor by dt and the unit normal vector field of the foliation. So this quantity is an energy density, which is in particular positive. But the problem compared to the case of Minkowski is that dt is null on the event horizon. And the consequence is that the energy density here degenerates near the event horizon so that it doesn't control all the components of the energy momentum tensor. So the control over the solution given by this conservation law is not good close to the event horizon. Next, if we want to prove Pontoise decay estimate using Sobolev inequality, something that we need to control is the L1 norm of the radial derivative of the solution. And the thing is that in contrast with the case of Minkowski, we do not have a direct control of the radial derivative of F in L1. And finally, there are trapped null geodesics on Schwarzschild at the photon sphere, but the fact that these orbits are unstable leads to dispersion so that we can prove decay estimates. But it is well known that, for instance, for the wave equation, in order to estimate the solution near the photon sphere, we need to lose regularity. So here we will see that we will need to lose something as well. And maybe the last question. So in Minkowski, we obtain time decay on the solution by using the fact that we can commute the equation by commutators with weight in T. And here, the commutators does not have weight in T. So the question is how to obtain time decay using vector field method. So for this, one way to do that is to adapt the RP weighted energy method of Dafermos and Ronyansky. So this method has been used many times in order to study the wave equation on black holes. And here I had to adapt it to massless Bleskov equation. So the key elements of this method are the following. So first, we need to use an adapted foliation, a foliation which is adapted to the radiative property of massless Bleskov fields. So more precisely, we will consider a hyperboloidal foliation or space-like null foliation, which join the future event horizon to future null infinity. So like that, we will be able to prove decay estimates for the energy flux through the foliation. And the reason is the following. So the energy flux through sigma tau here does not measure the energy radiated to null infinity and inside the black hole between time zero and time tau. And this has to be compared with a foliation by T equal constant hypersurfaces, where the energy flux through these hypersurfaces are preserved in time. So we cannot prove decay estimates using for the energy flux through T equal constant hypersurfaces. So we also need to prove a uniform bound for a non-degenerate energy norm. So this means that we need to improve the energy estimate that we obtain by using dt as a multiplier. And we also need a non-degenerate integrated local energy decay estimate. So on Minkowski spacetime, it would be an estimate of the following form. So this means that we need to obtain a bound on a spacetime integral over a domain which is bounded in space. And finally, we need to prove and exploit a hierarchy of R-weighted estimates in the faraway region, so for large R. And for instance, if we start by P equal 1, we would obtain an estimate on a space-time integral of F over a region of large R, which is bounded by a weighted initial norm of F. And by putting everything together, we can prove decay estimates for the energy flux of F through the foliation. And the main idea of the method is to transform spatial decay into time decay without using commutators and multipliers with weights in time. Okay, so finally, in this last slide, I will briefly give you the main ideas in order to prove to obtain all the estimates required for using the RP energy method. So for this, we use well-chosen vector fields as multiplier. Then we will need a more general process. But the idea is to use a vector field as a multiplier, and so that the error term in the energy estimate will have a good sign. Like that, we will be able to estimate a space-time integral with a positive integral. So for instance, for the uniform bound in time for a non-degenerate energy norm, what we can do is to use the redshift vector field and Dafermos and Ronyansky. And the thing is that, in fact, the future event horizon is a very favorable place in order to estimate the solutions. For the integrated local energy decay estimate, we can use a radial vector field as a multiplier. So in the language of the Vlasov field, this corresponds to using a weight of the following form here. So a function of r times the radial component of the velocity covector. But here, by doing such a thing, we obtain an integrated local energy decay estimate with a degeneracy near the photon sphere. And in order to improve the control, so near the photon sphere, we need to use a weight which is more general, which is not obtained by using a vector field as a multiplier. And by working a little bit, we can prove the following estimate. So this we estimate the space-time integral that we wanted to estimate by the initial L1 norm of F plus a weighted LS norm of F, where S can be arbitrarily close to 1. And the thing is that in the case of the wave equation, we had to lose regularity. Here, we need to lose some decay in V. We need to assume more decay in V on the initial data in order to control the space-time integral here. And finally, for the hierarchy of RP-weighted estimates in the faraway region, we can use the weights of the form RP time the outgoing component of the velocity covector with an exponent q, which satisfy the following condition. And by putting everything together, what we can prove is arbitrary decay for the energy flux of F through the foliation. And more precisely, if we start the hierarchy with RP here, with P, we can prove decay as 1 over tau to the P. And finally, let me briefly explain you how to obtain the Pontoise decay estimate. So the main issue is that in contrast with the case of the wave equation, we do not have a direct control of the L1 norm of the radial derivative of F. So here the idea is to use the massless Vlasov equation here in order to control the following quantity here. So we can control the radial derivative of the velocity average of F multiplied by the square of the radial component of the velocity vector. And after that, we can control the most important component of the energy momentum tensor. So by controlling it by n twice, where n is a strictly timely vector field. So we can control this quantity by a Hölder inequality, by a weighted L1 norm in V of Vr squared times Fs, where S is an exponent larger than 3. And since F to the S is solution to the massless Vlasov equation, we can apply what we did previously in order to estimate so the main component of the energy momentum tensor by a decay rate here, which can be arbitrary, where the decay in time can be arbitrary fast. And well, I think that I have just finished. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for an interesting talk. Are there any questions?
I would have a question. Leo, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. So I was just wondering, the last thing you just mentioned, this F to the S, this exponent. Can you briefly say what how this helps to take S higher than? This looks very interesting to me. Can you comment on this? What the benefit of this is, where this enters?
Yeah, so the thing is that so I can estimate Pontoise the velocity average when there is the Vr star square here. So the thing is that if you look, for instance, at the velocity average with Vt square, what we would like to do is to force Vr square to appear. And for this, I make an Hölder inequality. And I need for this to take S larger than 3. So you apply your Hölder inequality, and in one integral, you do not have F. You have 1 over Vr with a small exponent. And in order to be sure that this integral is finite, on the other one, you need to take S larger than 3.
Okay, thanks a lot. Thanks, Leo.
Okay, so I hope that it was clear, but it just comes from Hölder inequality.
Well, I get the idea. Thanks a lot, Leo.
So, may I ask something?
Sure.
Okay, so you're saying the rate can be arbitrarily fast, but surely the initial data will prevent you to be arbitrarily fast. So what governs a threshold for the decay rate?
Yeah, so I mean, if you start by the RP energy method by P, then you cannot prove a better decay than 1 over tau to the P. So you need, if you want to prove a decay as the following decay rate, 1 over tau to the P, you need to assume that
the initial data have a finite norm with this rate. Okay,
yeah, exactly.
Okay, great. So if they're compactly supported, is compact support preserved in this case? I have no feeling for this, but.
I think that, yeah, compact supported would be preserved in time. So for compact supported initial data, you could really prove arbitrary decay.
And you get a uniform estimate too.
Okay. Right, yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I have a question. I guess it's clear that this cannot work for massive Vlasov because you have stationary solutions. But does it mean that you would expect some instability for massive Vlasov on Schwarzschild?
I think that there is a result of Olivier Sarbar about that, he proved that there is a stationary solution, I think, because of the structure of the trapping, which is more complicated. I think that the trapping is stable, so you cannot prove such decay result on for the massive case. Okay. I think that the Kerr family would not be stable for the massive Einstein Blasov system.
Mm-hmm. Are there any further questions?
So what would happen then if it's not stable? What will happen with the solution?
So I cannot say for sure, but probably that, there are some solution to the massive Einstein Blasov system with a non-vanishing Blasov field, which are close to Schwarzschild. So you could expect when you perturb a Kerr black hole for the massive Einstein Blasov system to converge to such a solution.
And the Schwarzschild ones are known to be stable, or?
I don't think that they would be stable. No.
David, do you know anything about it, or is this something that you're looking at with Maciek Maliborski numerically, or?
No. But I know that so Jacques' student Fatima, she will give a seminar in the matter conference next in two weeks. So she has this, I think, this result that you can, what Leo just I think mentioned, that you can go arbitrarily close to Schwarzschild with massive solutions. So that means that. So if you perturb, I can just repeat what Leo said. So if you perturb, you will pick one of those solutions, and this is a static solution, and so you will not. So Schwarzschild will not be stable in that sense. But one of those solutions may be. But there's no rigorous result on any stability, even in spherical symmetry of those solutions, because that's very hard at the moment, at least.
Okay, I think it's time to move on. Thank you very much.